Hello, Internet. Obligatory disclaimer, if you haven't played Undertale or Deltarune, go play those now, because they're very good games, and I'm about to spoil them harder than a forgotten car turkey. Also, Deltarune is free, and Undertale is so cheap, it's practically free, so no excuses, go. They gone? Awesome. So hey, it's been 3 days at time of writing this, and I'm seeing a lot of misconceptions and missed content regarding the weird run. And, being a little sponge who hates their life, I immediately found myself tackling this run again, and again, from different angles, looking to suck up all that sweet knowledge juice. If you haven't heard of this run yet, and want to play it for yourself, here's a quick spoiler-free guide to getting things rolling. First, Noelle must freeze every enemy in each area, using Ice Shock. Spare, or lose anyone by melee, and the run will immediately end. You can tell if the run is still valid by the NPCs on the overworld. If they remain frozen in place, even when you leave the room and come back, the run is still valid. Second, when you talk to this NPC, say that you're Noelle, are something more, any other answer will end the run. If they offer to sell you the freeze ring, keep saying, get it, until you do. Third, don't touch this puzzle until you have the freeze ring. You can get the freeze ring by interacting with this NPC after you've frozen every enemy between the puzzle and the junkyard. Fourth, if at any point you have two dialogue options, one of which is proceed, always pick proceed no matter what. Fifth, before you enter this alley, you need to obtain and equip something called a Thorn ring. This becomes available by heading to this room, after you've frozen every monster in the area. Finally, after you have the ring, use it to cast your strongest spell during the next boss fight. And that's it. If you aren't aware, there are some triggers in this run, so trigger warning for psychological abuse, peer pressuring people into murder, gaslighting, mass murder, threats of violence, stalking, etc. Don't do anything in real life that you do in this run, seriously bruh, no psychologically manipulating reindeers. Tempting as it is, I'm not going to go into each scene and line of dialogue. If you want a full playthrough, or what have, I've linked some in the description. Either way, make sure you're familiar with the run before we proceed. So to begin with, if you've read some other guides, you may have noticed some differences in steps. In particular, most guides will tell you to begin by backtracking, to avoid talking to this NPC altogether, and to answer certain questions in very specific ways. Most of these supposed requirements are overly cautious. It's actually perfectly safe to talk to this NPC before you've finished clearing out the area. As long as your answer, we're something else, he'll wait patiently for you to finish freezing everyone, and then prompt you about the ring, next time you get within range. While there is some specific dialogue for Noelle, at this door, it's not required to interact with it to start the run. In addition, it's perfectly fine to use axe and melee attacks on enemies, as long as Noelle's Ice Shock is what deals the final blow. Your answers to this poster don't seem to impact the run, although you do get run-specific dialogue if you pressure Noelle to ride with you. You're also free to answer either, it's natural, or it's horrible, when you get to the first puzzle. In this case, I believe this is because the real consequence here isn't convincing Noelle that her thoughts are natural or horrible, but revealing to her that we can read her thoughts. Speaking of this puzzle, did you know you can actually interact with it a bit without breaking the run? As long as you don't step past the switch, the game will give you the chance to backpedal, which is surprisingly generous of it. By this point, you may wonder how we can be sure what will and won't break the run? But the game actually provides quite a bit of feedback. In addition to enemies remaining frozen on the overworld, there's also a little chime that plays immediately whenever you do something that breaks the run. There's a ring for when you freeze the last monster in the room, so you don't have to keep walking back and forth in the same place. You also might have noticed that no matter what direction you head after acquiring Noelle, the first monster you face will always be this very special Virovirokun. It's the only one which dies in one hit to a low-level Ice Shock, and which will explain battles to Noelle if you use X take care when fighting it. Another feature unique to Virovirokuns in this run is that they occasionally cry Happy New Year, 1997, which is pretty fascinating, since Spamton makes several references to 1997 as well, including a claim that it was his favorite year, presumably because his business was doing well. They don't seem to say it when there are ambulances though. After your first ice shock, you might notice Noelle's title change, from level 1 Snowcaster, who might be able to use some cool moves, to a level 2 Frostmancer, who freezes the enemy. She'll also have a slight increase to her coldness stat, which will be steadily rising as you fell enemies. Her boldness will also occasionally rise, in particular after cutscenes. Chris' description will change slightly too, from tactician who commands the party by axe, sometimes, to leader, who just commands. Enemies will begin spawning in areas they didn't previously, including the junkyard, and later the crosswalks. In addition, Lancer will stop asking if we can make Noelle a bad guy. Instead, he'll be snoozing in our party, with a message saying, "Innocent boys are fast asleep." You'll also notice most of the NPCs disappear, as well as the cars and traffic puzzles. Some NPCs will begin calling Noelle Angel. Spamton in particular uses the word Angel a few times, and if you played the secret boss fight, you may have noticed he also mentions Heaven quite a bit. I'm not sure why this is. Maybe it has something to do with the Angel that can bring about destruction or redemption in Undertale? Or maybe it has something to do with Father Alvin, who mentions an angel in Monster Religion. Actually, now that I think about it, aren't the angel and her heaven mentioned in the story Ralsei tells? That's up, a little ominous, now that we have some context. In addition to looking like an angel, Noelle's sprite also tends to look a lot like praying. When you get the freeze ring, the animations change further, adding a new ice wall while she's defending, and a snow globe enveloping her when she wins a battle. She also seems less alarmed at the start of a battle, when hit in battle, and when asked to throw a punch. If you examine it, the freeze ring, it says it appears to be a ring with a snow globe on it. Is that someone inside? Implying either that we trapped the NPC selling it inside the ring, or possibly, based on her battle animations, that Noelle is in some ways a prisoner of the ring. She actually lets out a sigh of relief when you switch back to the snow ring too, saying thank goodness, intriguingly. Susie actually asks if you stole it when you show it to her, while Ralsei just comments that it's beautiful. You know, on that topic, it's a little sad this is the only way to remove Noelle's snow ring, as both Ralsei and Susie have some pretty cute dialogue when attempting to equip it. Susie says it smells like Noelle, and Ralsei asks if you're proposing to him. Ah. When you get the freeze ring, you'll notice that the music has slowed down, and that enemies are now fleeing from you. After a while, Noelle will start freezing the puzzles without being asked, as well as actively asking if we're going to go look for more enemies. We all know by now that Spamton will be in the dog dumpster in this run, and he'll offer you the Ring of Thorns, should you take out the remaining enemies, even providing the number that still remain in a manner quite reminiscent of Undertale's genocide run. He actually references the run in a normal playthrough as well. Should you choose to use fight actions on him in his first appearance, he'll tell you that if you wanted to buy his ring, you should have started beating people up earlier. If you refuse to buy the Thorn ring, he'll ask why you came to his dumpster then. Which, I mean, fair. Once you buy it, you can check the dumpster again and he tell you not to worry about there, no money back, guarantee, because this is one purchase you will regret for the rest of your life. Good to know. Should you choose to terminate your weird run, you can actually keep the ring and show it to your party members. Susie will comment that it appears to be a torture device. Ralsei has no comment, as if he's thinking, "Oh hell no, I am staying out of this." Spamton will also update his dialogue when you fight him, saying,
"It doesn't mean you can beat me up just because you bought my commemorative ring. At least buy two. Too bad. See you, kid."
As of yet, this is the only dialogue change I know of related to a terminated weird route. For the most part, puzzles, character dialogue, and general scripting all reset back to how they were before you started the route. Even Chris is a level 2 tactician again, although Noelle will still have the same title, spells, items, and stats from whenever you ended the route. Although, her title is partly dependent on the rings, as Thorn Ring gives her the title, Ice Trancer, which receives pain to become stronger, so you can toggle that at will, if you want. Still, this actually makes the save right before Berdly rather tense. If you want to hold on to Noelle's watch and freak her out later at the hospital, this is your last chance to do that. If you're terminating the route for that Thorn ring, you also need to remember to de-equip it before she leaves the party. Not that there's much to do with it, aside from stare longingly at that twisted sword recipe in the bakery. One day. Speaking of the overworld, I've heard rumor of differences in the item descriptions of the computer room, and a change in the ambient noise is near this door during a weird run, but I haven't seen any evidence of it. If I had to guess, I'd say the trash can is likely referencing Chris' knowledge of Spamton, if anything. Enough beating around the bush, let's talk about that Berdly fight. If you say you're protecting Noelle from him, the run will return to the neutral run, so you won't get any of the cool spells or options. And there's actually a lot going on here. In this version of the fight, we have a few new act options. Checking Berdly will tell us he's weak to ice and suggest we try our strongest ice spell. Noelle still has her in action, but, like with the Pippis in the castle, it won't work if we try to use it. We can glare, which will lower Birdly's defense, and move him a little closer to the spare option, and we can wake Noelle by telling her to focus. And even though she'll reply that she doesn't know what we're talking about, it will power up her magic attack. It's interesting that this command is wake, as in common vernacular, people who aren't thinking for themselves are often said to be asleep, but this run pairs being awake with following orders and sleeping with dreaming and healing. Later in the run, the queen actually says that Noelle has already awakened too much, as if we've been burning her with the harsh light of violence, and suggests that Noelle needs to sleep and dream darker and darker dreams. But I digress. Berdly will always target Chris. The only way for Noelle to die is for Chris to be downed, while Noelle is low enough on health to die from the remainder of the attack, since the excess damage has to spill over somewhere. If you enter the attack round with Chris already down, Berdly will skip his turn to avoid hurting her, and he'll beg her to run away while she has the chance, but Noelle will say that she can still hear our voice telling her what to do. This motif is carried over into her Snowgrave spell. You can tell her to use the spell while Chris is down, and she'll still argue with us about the spell, and then use it as normally. If this happens, Chris will stay down for the duration of the cutscene, and after she leaves, you'll be revived with 20 health, so letting Chris die is actually a pretty valid strategy. Paired with Noelle, Susie's comments, and Chris's reluctance, or perhaps inability, to cooperate with Rossi later on, it certainly suggests that this isn't the sort of run Chris would want, even if they are a bit of a troll sometimes. It's a shame there aren't any more enemies ahead of us. It would be a delight to freak out Susie and Rossi with Snowgrave. Although, if you really want to, there is a way to use it on a normal enemy, at least once. I don't know if it's a glitch or not, but I've checked as of 1.0.5 and it still hasn't been patched out, so here's hoping we get to keep it. If you initiate the Berdly fight with Proceed, but end the fight without using Snowgrave, you can head backwards, and all the NPCs will have reappeared. The cheese puzzle will be back too, and since you never interacted with the cheese maze, you can use it to spawn a mouse enemy. This time Noelle won't argue with you about using Snowgrave, and instead of freezing or being lost, the enemies will be vaporized in a cloud of red dust and blood. Fatal indeed. And maybe it's a tad sadistic, but I really hope we get to hold on to this ability going forward in Chapter 3.